Like right when that year started, I was skyrocketing.
Yeah.
My patterns, gappers were just dumping.
Yeah.
And that completely changed. And so gappers are not the same anymore. And it hit me like an absolute train. And I did not adapt quick enough.
All right, we are back with Evan Schunk.
What's going on, Tim?
How you been?
Very good.
When's the last time we did this? We were on camera, what? Like, I don't even know.
A year ago?
Was it a year ago?
It had to be.
Something like that. You were doing really well. What have you done since?
Pretty stationary. Honestly, it's been a really rough year. Beginning of the year, I think I went up quick, like 100K. I lost it all. Then I went up 60K. Then I lost that. It's been very up and stagnant. I've been hovering around break even, it seems, all year, going up and down.
So what are you at overall? Plus
overall right now? No, I think I'm down minus 5K.
But overall, since
it began, 745.
Okay.
Yeah.
No, so you got to 750. Yeah,
I was like, I'm about to get hit. Almost got to 8, and then...
I didn't know how bad 2022 was going to be, but I had an idea that like when people made so much so quickly, usually at least you managed to hold on to it. Most people make that much in 2020, 2021, they lose it all.
Right.
So many crypto people, NFT people, like, they're sad now.
My data has shifted a lot. The data that was working in 2020 and 2021, these patterns that I banked off those 2 years, they stopped working, and there was some serious downtrends in them. And if you weren't quick enough to adapt to that data and change your system, you're going to deal with some really volatile times, and that's what I did.
Trading is all about adaptation.
Absolutely.
You know, not every year is going to be the same. What works in 1 year might not work the next year or the next month.
Yeah.
And a lot of people have problems with that. They're like, but it worked. I just, like, they get a hang of, like, a pattern. They're like, I just got it. And then the market doesn't care if you just got it.
Yeah, no, it
doesn't.
Right? It completely changed, and I updated everything now. It's a very prepare market, as you already know.
Yeah.
So I can't wait for it to heat back up because I'm so ready.
We're getting a little, don't get your hopes up, but we're getting a little more action these days. I was showing you MMTLP.
Sure.
You know, now we're seeing some big runners. November to May is historically the strongest time period for stocks. So I think, I don't know, I don't need it to get, busier. I'm only up like 100 grand this year. Like,
oh, wow.
I mean, it's decent. Like, it's, don't misunderstand me. Very grateful. But it's 1/10 basically of last year.
What you were doing, right.
So if people in like a normal job, like, okay, you have a salary and then you're doing the same amount of work and then you get a 90% drop in your income, you might be like, yo, this job sucks.
Right.
But that's trading.
That's trading.
Right?
Absolutely.
You're break even this year or down?
I'm break even. I'm down 5K, but I made 5K last week. I haven't even kept up to my profits these past couple months.
Yeah.
I haven't even cared.
Because it's I've seen a lot of this too, where like I start getting on a streak and then I screw up, like, you know, you're like, okay, now I'm back. And then it's like the market slaps you back.
And then it slaps you back.
Remember Mortal Kombat? Did you ever play that game?
Yeah.
Where it's like, get back there!
Oh, get over here, Scorpion.
Was it get over here?
Yeah, get over here.
Was it get over here or get back there?
Get over here.
Shoot, I don't even know. But that's like what it is, right? Where it's like you start getting a sense of like more profits coming. Sorry, I'm exhausted.
Yeah.
I don't know how you deal with the West Coast.
I love it.
Look at my eyes. Can you zoom in on my eyes, Pascal?
Of course.
Zoom in. Let's see if you think, leave a comment below. Do I love the West Coast? Do I love it? Can you look into my eyes? Can you see if I love this? Is this the eyes of a happy face? Zoom in on his eyes. Look at that. He's smiling as you're zooming in. Leave a comment below. Do you think I enjoy the West Coast? Or do you think Evan enjoys it more? How's your brother doing?
He's good.
Are you Evan or Ethan? Am I getting it
right?
I'm
Evan.
Okay, I'm getting it right. I thought you might just not be correcting me because now I'm like double, like I'm not sure.
You were saying Evan the whole time, right?
I think so. This is the West Coast. I don't know. I thought you might be being nice and being like, you know, that's not my name, but you don't want to say anything.
No.
How's your brother doing?
He's good. He's just living a very nomad lifestyle now. He's just in South America. He's been everywhere.
Why do you think traders become nomads? Why do you think we go out and travel?
Because there's not a single job out there that creates as more freedom as trading.
Yeah.
It's just that's the biggest reason why I pursued it, why I feel like most traders pursue it. You can go wherever you want. You take your laptop.
Preach in the choir, man.
You take your little hotspot in your pocket.
Yeah.
Wherever, your phone, so you got two.
Yeah.
And you can just be one with the wind. Just go out anywhere and trade and then I don't know, just go out and do something.
It's beautiful, right?
Yeah.
Are you excited to go?
I can't wait. I mean, the timing's going to be really bad over there. I think the market opens at 9:30 at night.
At night.
I'm going to trade on my phone. I'm going
to
get really
I actually prefer staying up all night to getting up at 4 or 5 in the morning.
That's true. That's
just me. And you don't need to trade all night, too. By the way, it's like 9:30 to like 12.
Exactly.
Sleep until like 2.
I need the first 30 minutes.
Yeah, right. Really. Yeah. You can sleep all night, right? Yeah. Like, just get a little bit. Right. So the most action is near the market open, at least for me.
Me too.
I didn't wake up this morning. I missed some morning panics. MMTLP had a perfect morning panic. There was another one that I saw that had a perfect morning panic. I don't even know. But I missed both morning panics because I tried to get up, then I was like, I feel like crap. I know I'm filming all day, so I'm like, I don't want to do it.
Yeah.
It's tough.
Yeah.
But you like getting up at 4 or 5 in the morning.
I'm up at 5 every day. I have to. I got to borrow shares because I'm only shorting the very hard to borrow stocks. It's nice, though, because I do have a little trading team that I'm with, like, including my brother and 2 other people. And if I do want to sleep in, like, they every now and then I can, because they can just call me if there's a play.
That's cool. I like that.
Right.
And still then, just tough. So I just great. Don't like You like waking up early.
Lately, usually the pattern's been I wake up, check the market, it's dead, go back to sleep, wake up at 6:20, check the market, usually dead. At least for a while, because I'm always trading NASDAQ. I haven't been getting into OTCs as much, but I didn't even realize that the market was moving the OTC.
OTCs are coming back.
They're coming back a little bit.
A little bit.
And so now I got to pay attention to that now, which I will.
MMTLP has been a big runner. Like Jack Kellogg has been shorting it. I've been going long. You know, he said like I bought it the other day at like $9.95 because I thought it would crack through 10.
Right.
And it dropped, so I cut my losses real quick. And he's like, Sykes bought the top. And I was like, shut up, you bastard short seller. Yeah. And then I rebought it at 10.01 and it went to 12.
Wow.
So it just keeps going to the 12s. Although today it dropped from the 12s back down to the 9s.
It's looking good now for a short maybe.
Listen, when you have plays that are up so much, there's plays long and short. You can choose one. You can choose both.
Yep.
There's endless opportunity. That's what we love. Yep. But I do find a lot of other traders are having the little ups, little downs.
And it's like, this year, even traders that I would that I know are way better than me. And so it's actually nice. It's just a little fresh to know that people way better than me are also struggling.
It's
this
good
year.
For you to like have perspective. A lot of people don't have perspective. They think that like you're always going to make money. Like when I'm trading a promoted stock and I post a loss, they're like, why even bother learning if you're just going to lose? And I'm like, sometimes you do lose on a promoted stock or any stock.
Yeah.
Why do you think people have such problems dealing with losses or the change where, you know, you're making hundreds of thousands 1 year, and now you're basically break even.
One, they hate to lose. Not enough experience, probably knowing how to lose. And knowing, because it takes so much time to know when you're getting in the trade and when it's a right trade. When you're jumping in, when you have an edge. I mean, that took me 2 years. So I can only imagine beginners, they look at it and they're just like, why is he getting in right now? How does he know? What is the trigger? What emotions is he feeling? And that just takes so much time.
How many years have you been trading now?
4.5.
Whoa.
Yeah.
Crazy ride.
I know, right? I still remember joining your chat 2018.
Nice.
April.
What'd you start with?
30,000.
Nice.
Yes.
Did you go down at first?
Absolutely.
How much did you go down?
10, 12K.
Okay.
Yeah.
And then you picked yourself up.
Picked myself up. Yeah.
And now,
I put a little bit more in just because I hate being under PDT.
Yeah. You spoiled.
So I put it. I had another, I think, 15K.
Okay.
But I didn't put in all of it. And then got back above it, and then boom, and I kept. But it took me 2 years. But
of course.
Yeah.
But now you seem to be dealing with like a break-even result. Okay.
It's a break-even year.
You don't seem too angry about it or frustrated. No,
because I understand all my mistakes. I've done my homework. I've updated my system completely. I've changed it. I concentrate on my patterns, having to pass the test of time.
Yeah.
Normally, I would trust 2 years of data.
Yeah.
No, I consider that terrible now.
Yeah.
I consider 3 pretty bad, 4 pretty bad.
Yeah.
I want to see my pattern successively going throughout the data in the stock market like at least 7 years, ideally 10. Then I could really trust that pattern.
So are you trading smaller now that you're not doing that well? Have you sized down at all?
Oh, well, I did, but not anymore. Now my patterns are tested completely. They're passing the test of time. I have enough sample size for each one to where I just can't wait for the market to come back.
What if you get, you said you made 60K, lose 60K.
Right.
What if you make 60K and now you know that the next thing in the pattern is probably lose the 60K. What if you just say, hey, I made 60K. I know what's coming next. Mm-mm. I'm going to cut it. I'm going to beat the system because I know what's next.
The data, the odds are that I'll be not happy if I do that. No, there's a lot more upside. Yeah.
Listen, people get very psychological. They think that the market is like playing games with them. You have learned to focus on your patterns, on your data.
Yes.
Maybe you win twice and lose once. Maybe you win five times and lose once. Right. But like, everyone's always scared of losing once and like breaking even or going back.
No, it's part of the game. It's just
why do people have such problems going backwards at all?
Maybe it hurts their ego. It hurts they get scared, their emotions. No experienced trader is going to have a problem going backwards.
Yeah.
So you're clearly not experienced
or
enough.
Sideways.
Right.
Or I think sideways. It also helps when you see other people, like you said, better traders. Right. I don't know anybody having a record year this year.
Me neither.
Okay? Even short sellers, even though in 2022, when we're filming this is like the worst stock market in years or decades for the, you know, the 60-40 portfolio where you have bonds.
Yeah.
And stuff. That's down 20%. Like, that's supposed to be a safe thing. Bonds are having their worst year. Like, it's a bad year.
Yeah.
And it's a bad year for you, but you're basically break even. Right. It's a bad year for me, but I'm up 100K.
Part of me feels like, I feel like there's not enough longs in the market, right? I feel like in 2020 and 2021, so many long buyers came in the market.
Yeah,
I
mean, stimulus checks.
Everyone's opened up an E-Trade account, anything. And everyone's just buying stocks. Yeah. And I feel like there's such a correlation there of why it's such a great time for 100%. Short seller patterns, at least mine.
So many idiots enter the market.
Right.
Just waiting. It was like, you know, before Thanksgiving, all the turkeys gather in one room and you're like.
So many gappers, like the 2020, the year of gappers failing was like phenomenal. I've never seen a year like that in the data going back 20 years.
No, it was beautiful. That we're going to show from, do you ever watch South Park?
Yeah.
I used to watch South Park. It's crazy. They keep going.
I know.
I stopped 7 years ago.
I stopped 2 years
ago. They keep going.
Yeah.
There was one before Thanksgiving, and it was funny, and they were making like a cartoon about what Thanksgiving is like.
Yeah.
And all these turkeys gathered into this movie theater, and there was one like leader turkey, and it was like trying to gather all the other turkeys to look at the movie screen because like the movie's about to begin. And they're all gobbling, and then the leader turkey's like, yo, turkeys, watch the movie screen. And they all of a sudden all look up, and then a giant blade comes and cuts off all their heads because it's for Thanksgiving. The stock market in 2020 and 2021, all these turkeys open Robinhood accounts, E-Trade accounts, and they're all focused on the stocks, and then 2022 came along and that's the blade. You like that analogy?
Yeah, that's a good one.
Do you have that photo? Can you find that photo? It's actually really funny. I can't see that far. I have bad vision. But people were rich, spoiled, and then lost it. You know, there's a saying, a fool and his money are soon parted. That's what's happened. I know some crypto people who went from like,
oh my gosh,
30K or 50K to like millions.
Mm-hmm.
And now they're back down.
And they still hold on to it? Yeah.
Of course. This is HODLing. This is HODLing 101. And the problem is, because I tried to talk sense into them, like just take 10% profits, take 20% profits.
Anything.
But the way that they made millions was ignoring all conventional conservative wisdom, saying you just don't understand.
Right.
And when they turn 20 or 30K into 5, 10, 20 million, I know somebody who made 20 million.
Wow.
They want 100 million.
Wow.
They're not thinking. I was like, there's somebody made 20 million. I was like, just take a million off. Take a million off. You still have 19. You can play with that? No. Diamond eyes, laser hands, whatever you want to call it.
Yeah.
And they didn't sell any. any. Like, none to live off of.
Yeah.
Like, it's, I don't understand. Like, how can you none?
Yeah. I know. I'm with you.
Are you in crypto at all?
No, but I had a buddy, a friend that.
Past tense.
He was like. He doesn't live still, no, he's actually better. He's closer with my brother than me.
Okay.
He was up huge. I think like over 700,000. Yeah. And he invested like maybe 20, 30.
20,000 into 700,000.
Right. And yeah. He didn't sell.
Any.
He didn't sell, I think, until he dropped back down to like 40.
Yeah.
And started until 30.
Yeah.
But not until nothing close to its top.
What do you think is worse? Making all that money and like having it be unrealized and not taking it and it coming down? Or, you know, just losing money? Like never even having a gain. And it doesn't matter because he didn't take it.
Right.
Right? Is it worse to go from 20K to 700K back to 30K? Or is it worse to go from 20K to 10K?
It's worse to go to 20K to 700K back to...
Because you had it. Yep. It was in the palm of your hands. No one, and you let it slip.
None of them understand. You don't make money unless you sell. And so they all just stuck with the same old habits of...
How do we get people to learn? Because I can teach them. I can talk about this. They just don't listen.
It's human nature. They probably won't. Not until they get really experienced enough and study and learn.
But then when they do lose, now they're going to be better students. Because now they're like, I see what you were trying to say.
And then maybe they'll pay attention more. You have to make that mistake a bunch enough. And then listen to your mentor. Find one. And then just let them drill some good teachings in your
head. I have so many emails and messages from people being like, I wish I would have listened.
Oh, man.
I'm like, I'm not trying to say I told you so. Like,
I can only imagine.
It's like mass delusions. And they're just like, you don't get it.
Right.
And as it turned out, they didn't get it. Mm-hmm. And it's like just a total, and all the like leaders of crypto, like Michael Saylor saying to mortgage your home, mortgage your business with Bitcoin at 60K. Yeah. Now, you know, he was up, I think he was up like, what, $2 billion unrealized?
Wow.
Didn't take it, now he's down $1.5-2 billion real unrealized. And he's not CEO anymore. He was CEO, then he got taken down. I was like chief like visionary BS. Yeah. There's actually a chart, you would get this, it's funny, you know Michael Saylor, MicroStrategy?
I mean, I've heard about him, but I don't even...
There's a chart where it's every time he starts tweeting more because he's nervous, that's usually right before Bitcoin drops because he's trying to defend it, but subconsciously, he knows that it's in trouble. The more that he tweets, the more Bitcoin is about to crash. And he sees it. He's done this like four times.
That's crazy.
He's done this like four times subconsciously because he's like, this is the time to hold everybody, and that's right before it crashes.
Wow.
Because he feels the forces circling him. And so he can't help it. And he tweets. And his tweets like double right before. His tweets are up. So now theoretically Bitcoin is on the verge of another leg down.
Yeah.
We don't know. FTX is nasty. There's all these other companies that are like commingled, intermingled loans and stuff. Yeah. Leverage.
Mm-hmm.
If FTX was a total fraud, there's probably some other frauds.
Yeah.
Like, how do you know who's a fraud? You've been in this industry for a while now. How do you tell?
Whoever tries to get you to ask for your money on the Bitcoin. Any Bitcoin person I've ever been messaged has been a complete criminal fraud. If you ever message about Bitcoin, it's a fraud.
That's pretty much rule of thumb. Yeah. I'm sorry. I think crypto has technology potential.
Yeah.
But it's like the Wild West, right? Like the Wild West obviously became like California, Nevada. Eventually it became very civilized. But in the beginning, it's like murders just like rampant.
Everywhere.
Because they found gold. Yeah. It's like the, you know.
What happened to NFTs? Where did that
go? NFTs got hit twice because the price of NFTs got dropped. And then Ethereum or Solana, which is based on. We were going to do charity NFTs on Solana.
Oh, okay.
But we had like charity merge. We had all this stuff planned. And Solana was at 100. I was like, okay, it's down from 240. We can work with it at 100, even if it goes down to 80. Yeah. But now it's 11.
Oh, jeez.
So you can't do anything with it.
Yeah, them too.
And the problem is a lot of Solana people, like one Solana equals one Solana. So this is like the mindset where it's like, no, the price hasn't gone down at all. I still have one Solana.
Oh.
But it's like your Solana is worth 1/20th of what it was against any other currency.
Yeah.
But they're like, no, I only deal in Solana. So it's 1-to-1.
My It's like, so I have, now I have a bunch of fake accounts too. I don't know why they target my Instagram. I only have like 700 followers on there.
Listen, it costs them nothing. We all have imposters. Yeah. We're never going to DM you. We're never going to tell you about some shady crypto wallet where you can double your money in 2 days.
And like most, half of my followers are like from my real life, like people that I've known, you know, growing up. And it's funny because like they're so unused to this. They have no idea. I've like, there was one time someone like, they made a dinner plans with a fake Evan. I'm like in a call. I'm like, what are you talking about? And
why do you think people fall for that?
I don't know.
Desperation for money?
I guess they make such good fake accounts. They're not used to it. They haven't seen it before. Stuff like that.
And I mean, if you ever
the people that actually fall for, like, I feel like people have actually fallen for your fake ones.
People fall like, for
and all send someone's. Money. I don't.
It's terrible. I wore it every day. I like, never follow. Wow. I don't know why you would believe like Timothy 5, 6, 7, and it's like they spell my name.
My name was Evan Schunk.
Yeah, right. And there's like. There's like pictures of like some random like Algerian guy. Like, and I'm like, what are you?
Sometimes they're really bad. Yeah.
It's just sad. It's a sad world. But you seem pretty happy.
I'm very happy. It's been a whatever year, but I mean, that doesn't stop me.
But you can live pretty well. You've learned on 750,000.
Exactly.
It's not just about making millions or billions.
Right.
Has your living style, living conditions increased since you've made like 750,000?
100%.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
What do you do differently? Help people get inspired a little. Most rich people, they can't talk about their money. They don't want to seem, you know, bad. But like, what's one thing? Like, it doesn't have to be anything huge. Just one thing that you enjoy more now.
Where I live, my house. I love where I live.
You upgraded.
I upgraded. Nice. Yes. That's my biggest one. I sleep in a king bed now.
Beautiful,
Tempur-Pedic.
Things can be simple. The bed that you sleep in, you spend like a third of your life sleeping. So if you increase that, right?
I go to nice restaurants all the time.
Yeah,
I love food.
A little different than before, right?
Absolutely.
I love food too. Yeah. We should go out to eat.
Absolutely,
you know?
I love food.
Now that you're steady, before, if you go back, we're gonna pick out some clips from your last interview. I don't remember what you said, but you had made a lot of money, and I was like trying to tone things down. I was like, calm down.
Yeah.
Especially you and your brother like to like, you take massive size.
Yeah, we take a pretty big size.
Massive, not pretty big.
Yeah, it's massive. Yeah, we do.
What size positions are you guys taking? Like, that's crazy.
I think I was in like 200K or something. Yeah.
Remind him, leave a comment saying cut losses quickly, okay? Do you guys believe in cut losses quickly, or are you more like cut losses intelligently?
That one. We're more like that one.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Every time I've cut losses quickly, it's been worse.
What do you mean?
Well,
it's not worse financially.
If it's going towards my risk and I cut it before it hits my risk,
then it comes back and you feel guilty for cutting it in the first place.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Listen, some people have their risks, you know, even if you're an evil short seller, I have to respect that. Just like if I was like interviewing, you know, a murderer on death row, you know, they're still a person. You didn't kill anybody except potentially your account in the future.
And we still do.
But your data has improved.
My data has improved.
I'm not anti-size. I'm anti-lack of preparation plus size.
Right. Size is only on the best plays. Like, I want my pattern to have at least 150 sample size with an 86% win rate.
Beautiful.
That is my massive size. Yeah. Yeah.
That's beautiful.
Yeah.
And that's how it should be.
Right.
Versus some people just like to take size for the sake of taking size because they like the adrenaline rush.
Exactly. And at least 7 years of data. That's my new standard of a pattern now.
So you're just a data cruncher.
I'm a data cruncher. That's absolutely fantastic. I have everything's quantified, all my trades.
And that's how it should be. I've been hanging out with Lucas, the short pair. I don't know if you know
him. Oh, yeah, I do.
He's sized up. He started with like $2,000.
Oh, wow.
And he was like selling his old like PlayStation. Like he would like, and he started like very young, but he started with just a few $1,000s and he, you know, very quant, very spreadsheet based trading. And now he's, you know, nine figures. Like, it's not just a million anymore. Like, he's 22.
And now he's shorting he's shorting Tesla now. Did you see that those Tesla trades? He just put a whole document on his Tesla short.
He made like $5 million.
It was incredible. Yeah. I was reading through it and I'm just like, I learned a lot.
He's 22.
It's crazy.
He also came on a hungry tourist trip. He out-ate me, right? It's like, I've been going on hungry tourist trips. I introduced him.
Wow.
And he's like, dominating. And it's like, there was a bad Will Smith movie where like he's a hitman and he has to kill somebody else. And then he doesn't ask questions who he has to kill. And then he looks through his scope and it's him. Someone like cloned him and it's a younger version of him. And he has to like kill his clone. And for me, this is like Lucas. Like, he's stronger, he's faster, he's younger, he's more successful. He's like half my age. I was like, this is, you know.
He's younger than Jack?
Yeah, Jack's 24.
Jack's 24. Wow.
Jack, and I just saw Jack Schwartz too, you know? Yeah. But he came out to eat too. Oh, so cool. Like, went out to eat in Stockholm. Now that I know you like to eat, now we got to eat somewhere too.
Awesome.
Can you eat a lot? You're not a big guy.
I eat a lot. I can eat.
What? Like two veggie burgers?
I can eat, well, I bacon cheeseburgers.
We'll see. We'll see what you can do. Now you're in. Now you're the 3/4 millionaire. You're quantified. You're humble-ish. Yeah. Are you humble or are you getting like cocky?
No, I'm pretty
humble. Has this year, do you think, helped you mindset-wise?
Yeah, absolutely. It taught me valuable lessons. I mean, data can change just like that. You can't just trust 1-2 years of data. I think you have to go deeper than that because out of nowhere, your system could just...
It's like a drunken driver.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
You're driving along, drunken driver comes out of nowhere.
Yeah. And the market changes can just everything. Change just like that. Yeah.
Did it surprise you how fast it changed?
I guess it did because I guess I haven't experienced such a market shift before because I only got profitable in 2020.
Yeah.
Like right when that year started, I was skyrocketing.
Yeah, yeah.
My patterns, gappers were just dumping.
Yeah.
And that completely changed. And so gappers are not the same anymore. And it hit me like an absolute train. And I did not adapt quick enough.
2020, 2021 was a rocket ship up. And then your rocket ship.
Right. The beginning of the year was okay. I went up 100K. And I was like, oh, this is great. I'm back. It's another great year.
Yeah.
And then boom, 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 boom. Got me back down to zero. And back to 60. Then back to zero. Back to 20. Back to zero.
But I'm impressed with how you've kept like the majority of your money. Like I know people who've been conservative, but they're losing like 20, 30, 50% of their accounts.
Right.
Which still would be amazing. Like even if you went from, you know, 30K to 300K in 4 years, that's still better than anybody else.
Right.
But you're 30K to like 750 or 745.
Right. Now, because I'm pretty sure I'm down.
How did you manage to like stay so close to your highs?
It's my data. I've adapted and I went through it all and I took out all the inks and errors and what's going on. Any pattern that was showing too much variability throughout the years, that wasn't showing inconsistency, I changed it. Or I needed to, I always keep my patterns very simple. Too many rules. I think you're overfitting patterns if you have too many rules in there.
Yeah.
So I stopped that. Well, I didn't really used to do that much, but if I felt like I was, I took that out.
Yeah.
And I took everything out and I just put years going all back to 2015, 10, and I wanted to see each year it was showing profitability throughout every single year.
Yeah.
And that's how I did it.
So would it be fair to say that even though you haven't increased your financial accounts this year, your knowledge account has grown?
Yeah, my knowledge account and risk management account has...
Huge.
Huge.
Which is necessary.
Yes.
If you make too much too soon with no knowledge or little knowledge and no risk management... Mm-hmm. You're going to lose it.
Absolutely.
Right?
Absolutely.
So this has been a good year. Mm-hmm. I'm excited for you to go to Philippines and Thailand.
Can't wait.
Will you take some cool like laptop shots?
I'm going to do that. Yeah. I'll be sure to tag you.
We need more. I need more laptop stuff. I don't know if you saw. I was in Italy. I'm in Italy right now on social media. I'm a little behind. But I went on like this cliff with this laptop with Matera behind me. Have you seen Matera?
No, I haven't been to Italy. But I'm going next June.
Really?
For a wedding.
Where?
Northern Italy, starts with an M. I forget the name of it. It's a very tip northern Italy. A lot of Germans like to go there.
Okay.
And my buddy's German.
This is Matera. Look at this. I'm on this cliff with this town behind me. Look at this view. Look at this. I'm on the side of a cliff.
You got a hotspot with you?
I do. The Wi-Fi was surprisingly good in this town. It's like the third oldest town in the world. Worked fine. I was like...
Your phone hotspot or do you have one that you...
I had a phone hotspot.
Okay.
You know, AT&T. It's simple.
Simple, fine.
Sometimes when I go to countries like at the airport, like in the Philippines, you should probably get a hotspot at the airport.
I do have one.
Indonesia too.
Okay.
But, or I guess you go to Thailand. Thailand too, probably. Get multiple hotspots. Yeah. You can afford it, rich boy.
Yeah.
You know?
They're
like $50.
Yep.
But I'm looking forward to seeing that. So be sure to tag me.
I will.
Trade less when you're traveling.
Okay.
Okay?
Yeah.
Enjoy. That's the beauty of trading. Where, yes, I'm on my laptop sometimes. I'm working, right, but only when a trade that's so good that I would feel guilty missing it, it pulls me out of my self-imposed retirement.
Retired trader.
Think about that. That makes sense to me. Mm-hmm. I know many people don't. They're like, what are you talking about? You're a retired trader. You trade every day. But that mindset is key.
Mm-hmm.
If there's no great trade, go enjoy Thailand. Go enjoy wherever you are.
Absolutely.
I'm looking forward to this.
Me too.
Let's see what more you can do.
Right.
Wish Evan good luck in the comments. And, you know, remember, it's not always about making so much money all the time. Sometimes you need the financial lessons, the risk management lessons. It still benefits you in the long run. How old are you?
31.
He's got plenty of time. We're going to live into the hundreds, maybe 200s. Read the book Lifespan. Have you read that book?
No, I haven't.
There's a book to read on the plane. We're going to live longer. So you got to think, okay, it's not just about how much money can I make while destroying my body or being so stressful.
Right.
It's trying to stay healthy and profiting in the long run.
Yeah.
So thank you again, man.
It's awesome. It was great to
see you. Say hi to your brother, too.
I will. I think he's in Colombia right now.
Crazy life. I love it. See you.